the Honourable Member for Wolseley.
Thank you very much, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I want to thank the member for River Heights for the words that he put on the record just now, and for the ideas that he brought forward during the debate on Bill 16. It was a very good and rare, perhaps sadly rare, moment of bipartisanship between our two parties, where we supported each other's amendments to a truly horrible plan and legislation brought forward by the Pallister government. It struck me to no end, Mr. Deputy Speaker, that when the recent poll came out, I believe it was earlier this week or maybe late last week, indicating that only 24% of Manitobans actually believe this government and what it says about climate change, the Premier's response was, well, that's too bad. He didn't even understand where that could be coming from. My question is, what's wrong with those remaining 24%? We've got some more public education work to do there, but the vast majority of Manitobans, three-quarters of them, have seen through the spin, have seen through the deceptions, have seen the cold-hearted bullying that's going on, and they don't like it. They want this government to be acting on behalf of their futures and their children's future, and this government has done the exact opposite from day one. It is no surprise to me that Manitobans are rejecting this premier and rejecting this government on climate change, and all the premier has to do to get an answer for why is it that they don't believe me is look in the mirror. The premier wants a brief history. Well, here we go. Here's some actions that he and his government have taken on climate change. Bad actions, which might just be contributing to the fact that people don't believe him. Well, he wants to pretend they're serious about climate change. What would we do about energy efficiency, Mr. Deputy Speaker, if the government was serious about climate change? Well, you would promote it. You would build on the success of the past. Power smart, enormous expertise. They share it with the world. They have saved Manitobans over $150 million in the history of that program. What does the Conservative government do? They freeze it. They stop using the name. They forbid Power Smart from even advertising their programs, never mind bringing in any new ones. That's going to sit well with Manitobans, right as prices for electricity and natural gas are going up. This government says, nope, we're not bringing in anything new. We're taking away the stuff that existed in the first place. They even went so far, Mr. Deputy Speaker, as to hire a worker to paint over the Power Smart sign on that mural at the corner of Portage and St. James. They do not want to give anyone an opportunity to save money as they crank up costs for them. That might be part of the reason why people don't believe this premier. And then he announced Efficiency Manitoba, one of the most ironic names in the political history of the environment in Manitoba. It's so efficient, it has not existed for 2.5 years. You can't get more ironic than that, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Where is Efficiency Manitoba? When is it ever going to get started? It has no CEO. It has no budget. It has no plan. It has no programs. People can't access it to make a difference. But why, the Premier wonders, why don't people believe me when I say I'm serious about climate change? Look in the mirror. Let's go on to transit. Wouldn't you know it, when this Premier was a cabinet minister, and I know not everyone can stand listening to the truth, some people will decide to leave. Some people will decide to stay. The words will be on the record. I hope that anyone who isn't here has a chance to read it later on, because everything I'm saying is on the public record already. It's a useful reminder. Let's talk transit. When the Premier was a minister in the film and government, what did they do to public transit across Manitoba? Did they support it? Did they give it more money? Did they encourage it? No, they tried to kill it. They got rid of the 50-50 cost-sharing agreement, which would see the provincial government and the municipal governments cost-shared public transit equally. They got rid of that because they don't believe in public transit, and they love to beat up and blame poor people for their problems while making it worse for low-income people and anyone trying to live a green lifestyle across Manitoba. Well, we come to office, we restore the 50-50 transit agreement and support public transit. We even go so far as to partner with Red River and Hydro and Mitsubishi Industries and New Flyer, and we create a brand new product by working together, a dare I say, a made in Manitoba solution. Oh, what is it? It's the first made in Manitoba all-electric bus. Four of them are put on the roads in the city of Winnipeg. The 50-50 transit agreement is restored. The Pallister government comes to office and says, oh my God, we can't have this happening. This is successful. Kill it. Kill it. Kill it. And they did. They've killed the 50-50 funding agreement for all public transit fleets across Manitoba. And where are the electric buses? Where are they? Yeah. They made entire movies, Mr. Deputy Speaker, over who killed the electric car. I can tell you who killed the electric bus. It's the guy who sits in that seat over there and blames everyone else for his own mistakes. It's the Premier of Manitoba who's to blame for those electric buses now sitting in New Flyer's yards, not being used, and nothing to replace them. And the crazy irony about this is even for a Tory should be able to figure this out if they actually care about money, because wait for this, Mr. Deputy Speaker, wait for it. An electric bus will save $60,000 a year. $60,000 a year in reduced costs on fuel and reduced costs on maintenance. Ah! The environment and the economy working together. No! Kill it! Torpedo it! Get rid of that, says the Premier, and it's gone. Why don't people believe the Premier when he says he's serious about climate change? Oh, I don't know. Let's look for the electric bus. We will not find it anytime soon. Oh, and let's continue. Let's order. Continue.
Order.
No, oh, we'll get to that. Don't worry. We will get to that. Don't worry. Here's another staunch hotbed of socialist NDP history, the Trucking Association in Manitoba. They came to this government. They had discussions with them. It was understood between the government and the truckers that any funds raised from carbon taxing would go back to help the truckers make their fleets more efficient. Instead, what happens? The government cuts the wheels literally out from under one of our largest local industries, and the truckers end up going public with words like betrayal. They were betrayed by this government, and the government's now losing thousands of dollars because the companies are quite rightly outraged and they're registering their rigs in neighboring provinces. So the provincial government doesn't even get that source of revenue. Another brilliant example of business management and environmental protection from the Pallister government, and he can't understand as the Premier why people don't believe him on climate change. Then there was the solar subsidy. Oh, no. Such a successful program. Vastly exceeded Manitoba Hydro's projections. Vastly exceeded anyone's projections. We will have over 50 megawatts of installed solar power because of that program, which I might point out started before this government even took office. So to the point from my colleague here in front of me wondering, what did you do in office? Well, that would be an example, just one of many. But there you go. You can think about that. And lo and behold, what does the Pallister government do? Oh, no. It's economically successful. It's creating hundreds of jobs. It's cleaning up the planet. Kill it. It's gotta go. And they're the only jurisdiction in the world that solar companies are even aware of that have done that. All over the world. Instead, what you do is you would announce a phase down. You would phase down a subsidy if that's what you wanted to do. But no, Pallister government kills it outright. No more solar subsidy. Where are all those solar companies now? How many jobs do you think they have confirmed since the subsidy ended? Zero. Zero, Mr. Speaker. Not a single new contract for any of those companies in Manitoba since this premier killed the solar subsidy. But he doesn't understand why people don't believe him when he talks about climate change. Now, those are just a few of the bad actions that this government has taken. Let's jump in to this so-called plan of theirs for climate change, which is actually a green scam. It was a green scam when the Premier and the Sustainable Development Minister last year at about this time dragged everyone out to Okamek March and announced this new approach that they were going to launch, and they knew it was a scam when they were telling people the exact opposite. And here's why we know this now. The government in advance actually had two economic models conducted, two of them. They've only ever released one. Why do you think that might be, Mr. Deputy Speaker? Because the second one didn't tell them what they wanted it to say. It actually said if you want to be serious about reducing emissions, you have to increase the price of carbon at a minimum every year. As soon as the carbon price goes flat, well, then actions to reduce pollution will go flat as well, about as flat as this Premier's lines in question period on climate change and pretty much everything else. Yeah. Well, lo and behold, they've never released that second study. They don't want anyone to know about it, but we do know about it now because of FIPA information that was released under law by this government. They have never released it themselves publicly. That is just absolutely inexcusable that they have been telling people all along that their plan would work when they knew full well from day one, even before day one, that it would not work and didn't have a hope of doing so. Let's also look at this plan. It is completely devoid of any connection to climate science. And climate science, let's make no mistake, Mr. Deputy Speaker, is this Premier's greatest failure on climate change. The most recent report from the United Nations Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change was absolutely clear. If we do not become, as a world, carbon neutral by 2050, and if we do not manage to reduce our emissions by 45%, by 2030, we're cooked. We have literally cooked our future. How many people here plan to still be alive in 2030? All right, that's 10 years from now.
Gee, I really...
How many of us would hope that our kids or our grandkids might still be alive 10 years from now or in 2050? That's every single one of us, Mr. Deputy Speaker. And yet this Premier is telling us that, no, climate science has no place in his legislation. He didn't put it in his plan. He didn't put it in his legislation. And when I brought forward multiple amendments to correct that horrendous oversight, what did his sustainable development minister do? What did he do? They led all the conservative MLAs in voting every single one of those amendments down. But he doesn't understand, Mr. Deputy Speaker, why people don't believe him on climate change. That might be one of many reasons that they could choose from. There is also a slight problem with this so-called plan. It has no targets. I was at a workshop just yesterday. City of Winnipeg now has a climate change reduction target. They've got a timeline. They've got a target. That's really good. What do you think we have in Manitoba from the provincial government? We got nothing. We got nothing. No targets anywhere. No timelines. Da-dee-da. Everything can keep going exactly as it wants, and that will be just fine. No, it won't be. And wouldn't you know it, the counting system that these so-called bastions of calculators would like to use is devoid of any truth whatsoever, and no one else in the world uses it, because it would only count reductions in emissions and ignore all the increases, and it would use this ridiculous thing called accumulative counting, which means if someone reduces their emissions in year one of a five-year plan, the Pallister government's going to steal that, and 5 years later they'll say, oh, no, that wasn't just one ton, that was 5 tons. No, it wasn't. No one in the world does it that way. But that's the level they had to stoop to in order to try and get their numbers to work. And they still don't work because in their list of actions that they would like to take, which they have never taken, I might point out, they laid out a whole bunch of things and put some numbers next to it. Oh, yeah, when we do this, emissions are going to go down by that. And when we get to this in about 400,000 years, well, it'll go down by that much. Well, lo and behold, the numbers aren't accurate, Mr. Speaker. They're completely made up in some categories. They're claiming that reducing the use of coal in Manitoba, that'll be a 100,000 reduction in emissions. One little problem. The Brandon coal-fired plant was the last one in Manitoba. When do you think it stopped using coal? When did it stop operating, Mr. Deputy Speaker? Well, it registered zero emissions for the entire calendar year of 2016. That means it was done operating and polluting 2 full years before this plan would ever take effect. But this plan's going to claim $100,000 reduction from that action, which was already taken by, who was in office? Who was this? Somebody was in office in 2016 and in January when that would have started. Yeah. That would have been the NDP. You know, that's another thing that happened under us. That's another one. You see? Oh, wow. What a list we're building. building here, and we've only just got started. So this so-called plan, which is devoid of science, devoid of targets, devoid of any action, devoid of any sense, now has to actually steal and misrepresent the truth from the record of the previous government to even present its phony ideas to the general public. That is the level to which this government is going to stoop over and over and over again to try and excuse its horrendous behavior on climate change. They know what they're doing. They've known it from day one. They've known what they're saying isn't true, and they're going to continue to do it. Now, here's a few other minor little problems with that so-called plan they brought forward. The price would have gone up for everybody. My constituents, the renters, living in an apartment block in West Broadway. Well, when the price of natural gas goes up under this government's plan, there's no new programs available for them to try and reduce it. For a homeowner, the same thing. For a community center, for a place of worship, for a school division, for a university, a college, anybody. All the prices go up, no new programs available. What do you think this government would ask large emitters to do? What would make sense? If you had even a modicum of fairness in your body, what would make sense if there's someone creating a lot of pollution over here and then a whole bunch of people who don't have nearly as much money, you know, creating a little bit? Well, who should? Maybe everyone at a bare minimum should be asked to participate, or maybe you start with the large emitters. No, large emitters wouldn't have to do anything under this provincial government's plan. Not a thing. Large emitters completely off the hook, and everyone else gets it in the shorts. Why do people not believe the premier when he complains no one understands his words on climate change? Well, and it gets worse on a rich poor front, because with the revenue that this government would have been receiving, would they have put even a nickel of it into climate action? Would they have done anything with that carbon revenue to actually address the severity of climate change, drop our emissions in half in a decade? Would they have done any? No, of course not. This is a conservative government that governs for itself and its own tiny 1% of the population. That's the only people they care about. And that is reflected in what they would have done with the carbon revenue. Would any of it gone to carbon climate action? Not a whit. Would more of it gone to low-income people and the rich? that's a good one. No, of course not. It's the reverse. Because the rich need to be incented to, you know, do whatever it is they do. They deserve more money than the poor do under the Tory worldview. That's what they would have done with the revenue. The wealthiest 10% of families in Manitoba would have got 10 times more money in a rebate from this government on the carbon tax than the poorest families in Manitoba. Every single Tory MLA has voted over and over and over again to implement their plan before the premier threw a hissy fit and threw it all out the window, of course. But they were fine with that concept, because that's what Tories do. They do not govern for everyone. They do not govern for the future. They govern for themselves. They govern for greed. And that is reflected in their plan over and over and over again. I also need to take them to task, because of all of the emissions coming out of Manitoba in their plan, only about half of them would have had any carbon pricing assigned to them at all. Again, it gets back to the challenge of why is it that they are fine with hurting all of the low-income people, the middle-income people, but the largest sources of the problem, of course, are being given a free ride. And then here is probably the part that befuddles me the most. We live in a province where nearly all of our electricity is created without burning fossil fuels. The four examples that I know of are still the off-grid communities in the north of Lac Brochet, and Shamattawa, and those communities still operate on diesel. Everywhere else, we are using electricity that does not require fossil fuels to generate. And yet our premier thinks it's a better use of his time as the premier of a fossil fuel electricity province to pick fights with everybody in his path, and even some people who aren't on his path, rather than looking at the transition to a green economy as a huge opportunity for Manitoba. There is no rational reason why anyone should believe this premier gets that. And he's the last one who should be surprised when we live in this type of a province, generating more electricity than we ourselves need, putting us in a position to help other jurisdictions reduce their emissions and create more jobs here in Manitoba and earn more money here in Manitoba. But no, no, he doesn't get it. And it's not just that idea he doesn't get. He doesn't get any of the ideas that are out there. And these aren't just mine. Let's look at composting. Oh my goodness, Mr. Deputy Speaker, if you wanted to pick one project that would make a huge impact, composting would be a great way to start. But where are we? The Green Plan doesn't even mention waste reduction issues in it. They totally missed that in their so-called four pillars approach. They missed it in their legislation. They had nothing on recycling, certainly nothing on organics recycling, also known as composting. And composting can help climate change twice. It helps because we have fewer organics going into the landfill. It's that part of the waste stream which creates the most methane, and that methane then escapes from the landfill, and that's why three of our top 10 large emitters in Manitoba are in fact landfills. When you reduce the amount of material going into a landfill, you reduce your emissions. And lo and behold, are we going to create jobs in this province by setting up composting in Manitoba? Well, I don't know. Maybe the trucks will all be operated by volunteer Tories who will just happily get up at 6 o'clock in the morning and cycle around on their bicycles and pick up the buckets of organics and cycle them out to Brady Landfill. No, Mr. Deputy Speaker. This is an opportunity to create hundreds of jobs, not just in Winnipeg, but in every major city, every city, let's start with, in Manitoba. We could set up urban composting, and that would reduce our emissions and create jobs. And you know what, Mr. Deputy Speaker? It could even end up saving farmers money. Oh my goodness, what did I just say? Did I just say saving farmers money? That's not going to get anyone's attention on the opposition bench, I'm sure, because lo and behold, what's the finished product of composting? It's compost. It's good for the soil. It make plant grow. Very simple. You put that on your fields, and you don't have to buy as much of the artificial fertilizer from the Koch brothers plant in Brandon. Yes, the same Koch brothers who've used their billions in profits worldwide to fund pseudo-climate science and to give a kickstart to the Tea Party and the right-wing populism that we now see running amok in the United States. Why on earth would we want to reduce our dependence on their product by using our own natural resource here, keeping it out of the landfill, creating jobs, reducing our emissions, saving people money, and saving the world? Well, that sounds like a horrible idea. You're right, Mr. Premier. No way that should ever happen. That was actually the first announcement that I made after becoming environment critic, Mr. Deputy Speaker. That was like well over a year ago, a year and a half now maybe, and there's been zero action on that front anywhere. Electric vehicles. I already touched on the electric bus. Another idea I put out there, electric vehicles. They are cheaper to own and operate already over the lifespan of the vehicle. The main problems are charging infrastructure, which this government could very easily set up, but they're not doing it. The technology exists now that didn't exist even a few years ago. It's being rapidly adopted elsewhere. They're sitting on the idea and not doing anything with it. So we do need better charging infrastructure, but the biggest challenge by far is for most consumers, it's the higher upfront price. So what do all the bean-counting geniuses in the Tory caucus do? Well, they don't do anything. It's like, well, it costs more, therefore we're not going to do anything about it. Yeah, that's it. No. All you got, well, that's assuming they have caucus meetings at all, which it doesn't sound like they do, because when the premier ripped everything up, nobody in caucus knew about it. So, you know, it's always fun to find out you're living in a dictatorship. But the electric vehicles, all you'd have to do, Mr. Deputy Speaker, crazy idea, why don't we take a little bit of the money raised by a carbon tax and you put it in a fund And then you make that money available to Manitobans so they can afford to purchase the electric vehicle. You don't even have to give it to them as a grant, which is what has happened in other jurisdictions. Because the problem with that, one, very expensive for government, and two, most of the money ends up going to higher income folks who can still afford to buy the more expensive vehicle. So how about this instead? I pitched this idea almost a year ago. It was February, south steps of the legislature. And the idea is very simple. You make a no-interest, long-term loan available to people in Manitoba so they can afford the higher price of the electric vehicle. And then when their operating costs drop by thousands of dollars a year, they have the ability to pay the loan back and actually come out ahead, Mr. Deputy Speaker. So wait a minute. Let's review this now, okay? Let's review this. We have one approach, which, you know, fossil fuel vehicle, we have to import the fossil fuels from elsewhere, and when we use them, they kill the planet. Or wait for it, we could use an electric vehicle, and we use electricity made in Manitoba, which would earn more money for Manitoba Hydro, and the government doesn't have to spend money to do it because the money comes back as people pay off their loan and people actually save money. You want to know how much it costs to operate an electric vehicle, how much it costs in gas to operate an electric vehicle in Winnipeg for the entire year? You can ask any of the members of MEVA. They'll give you their own experiences. If many of them are over $200 a year, I'd be shocked. Like, you have to put a lot of kilometers on your vehicle. Think of that. $200 a year to power your vehicle for the entire year, including winter driving. You can even warm up the vehicle before you get in the car. And they can work on the rural areas. If you've got yourself a charging station, which I know this government's ideologically opposed to charging it up. You know, they're ideologically opposed to it. But if you did these tiny things, Mr. Deputy Speaker, oh my goodness, you would again be creating more money in Manitoba. You'd be creating more wealth in Manitoba. We would not have billions of dollars leaking out of our economy to pay for fossil fuel imports, which we shouldn't be using in the first place, because if we do keep using them, we're going to cook ourselves. So, Mr. Deputy Speaker, I think that one's a pretty good idea. Has anything happened other than the killing of the electric bus? No. Oh, and where did my good friend go? He was here. Oh, I got another one for him. Because there was a program we brought in, the hybrid vehicle program. Anyone remember that? Wildly successful. That was something we did while we were in office, and for the government of the day, they've done absolutely nothing. There's been no new incentives brought in at all, and we're right on the cusp of the electrification revolution, Mr. Deputy Speaker, but they don't want to believe it. Let's talk retrofits. Let's talk housing retrofits. Do you know how many jobs you can create? With how much of your GDP will go up with every dollar amount you put into energy efficiency work, actually helping Manitobans, even helping Manitoba businesses. I just say that. I'm sorry to whisper it, but I know they don't want people to know how bad their approach to this is. But you could help businesses in Manitoba save money. You could create jobs. You would create between 30 and 50 jobs for every $1 million of economic activity going into retrofits, helping people save money, helping our local economy here, helping create jobs, helping training opportunities, and oh yeah, not cooking our future. But here we have a government and a premier who just can't understand why people don't believe him when he talks about climate change. Oh, the poor guy. I hope my speech here has helped clarify it for him. The single biggest problem, a single biggest obstacle in addressing climate change in Manitoba is the Premier of Manitoba. Full stop. And a final message to the Premier, this incredibly destructive Premier and his apparently completely irrelevant Sustainable Development Minister, who learns along with the rest of us what the guy is doing. You cannot cut your way out of the climate crisis. You cannot stick your head in the sand in the face of overwhelming climate science and tell anyone you're doing a good job of governing this province now and into the future. The only thing that I can hope for, what I hope for, Mr. Deputy Speaker, is for that day when the good people of Manitoba do to this Premier what he's been doing to them since he came to office 2.5 years ago. Cut him loose. Get him out of here. Same with every other Conservative government in this country and in this world. That's the only way we're going to have a shot at addressing climate change and saving ourselves is getting rid of this incredible, cruel, cold-hearted, incompetent, ignorant government of Manitoba. Hey, 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 hey.